landscape itself is, without a doubt, otherworldly. Barren, rocky. Mars, at least for now, remains a place untouched by humans. But, just so you know, this isn't Mars. Those tiny yellow specks on the hilltop, those are humans. And this is Hawaii, on the shoulder of an active volcano. Those humans are volunteers who've departed Earth, sort of.
What I miss most about my life back on Earth is my fiancé. I miss all of those little moments during the day that you have together.
So we're here at a mock Mars simulation. I think I can speak for everybody that we all would go to Mars. You know, we're living the astronaut life here.
Six people who last year agreed to live together like this for 8 months as if they were actually in a habitat on faraway Mars. And as it would be if they were on Mars, all of the video was taken by those at the habitat for CBC News.
Bye, CBC. I love you.
All communications, our interviews, even emails are on a lengthy time delay.
So the whole thing is an exercise in kind of patience and humility and doing your best to find out what parts of you you need to pull out and amplify and what parts you need to pull back a little bit so that you can be the best crew member, teammate for the rest of your crew members.
The experiment is funded by NASA as it considers an actual mission to the planet, one of near countless projects underway with that goal. So, they grow their own food, just like in the movies, and they conduct science experiments, just like they would on Mars. But the key aspect is testing interactions and behaviors under stress, because in theory, they're millions of kilometers from anyone else. Supplies are sent in periodically, but otherwise, they're on their own.
Oh, that's so horrible.
No matter the challenges, big or small.
My worst moment was probably being stuck in the airlock with a lot of poo.
And forget about feeling the sun or a cool breeze. Every time they go outside, they have to suit up for real. It's hard slogging. But one conclusion they've all reached is that getting to Mars is 100% achievable.
It's definitely not a pipe dream. It sounds like a lot, but I think we'll get there eventually in very little bit of time. The pieces are out on the table. It's putting that puzzle together. That will happen relatively soon, I believe.
I think that technically, we can absolutely go in my lifetime. I think that we could start working now if we needed to. Like, it's a matter of how much risk are you willing to accept for the people who go?
And this is where it's like feeling, sitting outside, just looking at the rocks and being like, you know what? It really does feel like Mars.
Martha Lenio, now back at her home in Waterloo, Ontario, lived in that habitat on an earlier 8 month mission.
How did you not go stir crazy?
Having very good crewmates.
She emphasizes that as engineers work on the technical challenges of getting to Mars, it's equally important to sort out the psychological ones.
The goal is to figure out how you pick a crew and support a crew for these long duration isolated space missions so that people won't go crazy and kill each other, because you're going to be confined in a small space with five other people for up to 3 years. So that does take a fair bit of social ability.
And so they're studying you, basically?
Yeah, we're the guinea pigs in a psychology experiment.
Viking Lander 1 has safely landed on the surface.
It's not like there isn't already stuff on Mars. NASA's Viking Explorer got there in the 1970s and sent back these images. Other robotic missions have followed. These images, each of them stunning, were taken not long ago by NASA's latest Mars rover, the Curiosity. But getting people to Mars and then home safely to Earth is a whole other matter. So, thousands of kilometers from that habitat in Hawaii, at the Johnson Space Center in Houston, NASA engineers whose job it is to think the unthinkable and who are busy on all kinds of things these days include Mars on their interplanetary to-do list.
We're an electric spacecraft, right? So we have solar arrays on the service module.
That's a mock-up of a space capsule called Orion. Najoud Meranci leads its development and gave us a peek inside. It's about the size of two minivans, and when it's finished, is meant to get astronauts out beyond Earth's orbit for the first time since the days of Apollo, taking the first step toward Mars. But that's the easy part. Challenges in deep space loom. Radiation, illnesses, fuel, just one chance at a safe landing, and then the rest of it.
You're gonna need a big habitat. We're gonna need big solar cells, systems, power, food, water, all those things. And then you're gonna need a rocket to get them back off the surface of Mars. So all of that has to be there even before the crew arrives, because you can't have it show up later.
And remember that time delay communicating with Earth?
So that means if I told you there's an emergency on the spaceship, the ground team would not know that it's happening until 12 minutes later. And if they had an instruction to send back, it'd be another 12 minutes to get back. If there's a fire, if there's a leak, all of those things have to be dealt with by the crew independently, which is certainly a challenge we haven't faced in any human spaceflight so far. And there's been a lot of challenges, but the ground's able to assist.
It sounds daunting.
It is.
But NASA's gigantic complex in Houston is littered with evidence it's managed daunting challenges before. That's a Saturn V at an on-site museum, the kind of rocket they once used for that other dream, getting to the moon. Meanwhile, just down the street a ways, more evidence NASA's now looking much further afield. We're told to please keep our voices quiet.
And these are, that's what's going on behind us right now. These are the people in there, right?
Yes, that's correct. We have surveillance cameras inside the habitat.
Another habitat with more volunteers inside, this time as if in a spaceship flying toward an asteroid, the kind of trip that might one day target Mars. We had a tour of the simulated mission control with NASA's Andy Self.
The thing about this is, unlike a normal mission control here, they are actually right there.
Yes. Like,
that's how close we are. That's them, right?
We're about 30 feet away. Yeah.
Wow.
For this test, the volunteers are inside with no windows, just cameras and each other, ostensibly en route and isolated for 45 days.
Can we get a status?
NASA experts watch how they get along. Unlike the habitat in Hawaii, for those simply flying through space, there's much less to occupy the time. So they're studied to see how pure monotony might affect their thinking and actions.
It's basically looking at human nature, seeing how it may unfold, and then countermeasuring it to ensure that it doesn't pose a risk to the mission.
And then there's the biggest challenge of all, money. On that, NASA's been busy with traveling exhibits, promoting even the idea of spending the billions of dollars such a trip would cost. Check this theoretical Mars vehicle, a crowd pleaser aimed at winning the hearts and minds of, yep, taxpayers and their kids.
You guys could be the first ones on Mars. How cool is that?
Public support is crucial. Meanwhile, private companies now play a key role as well. SpaceX, owned by billionaire Elon Musk, famously is now a mega player in the push toward Mars, and Musk himself a mega promoter.
What I really want to try to achieve here is to make Mars seem possible, make it seem as though it's something that we can do in our lifetimes, and that you can go.
In other words, he says, dream big. Working alongside NASA, SpaceX hopes to get to Mars by the middle of the next decade.
This is just seated.
So, what to make of all of this? Who better to ask than someone who theoretically could go? Canada's David Saint-Jacques. Prepping for his imminent trip to the space station, he thinks about this stuff a lot and bottom lines it this way.
Yes, it's risky. It will always be. Spaceflight is
maybe the most dangerous thing humans have ever done. But we have learned a lot in the process, and that makes it worth it. So eventually we will go to Mars when that risk balance kind of makes sense.
This is NASA. We make it possible, right? And I'm an engineer, and that's my job, is to solve problems. So I think these are all things we can do. It's not easy, and we need a lot of people working on it to make it happen, but I certainly think it's possible. These are within the realm of human capability, in my opinion.
Meanwhile, they keep at it, finessing Orion, getting it shipshape, balancing those risks while considering all the other challenges. Will there be the money for it? Says Saint-Jacques, there are many important earthly priorities, but...
The priority, of course, should never be space exploration. There's other things that are more important right now. But we should always keep a little sliver of the pie for blue sky research, for the arts, for exploration, because that is how we progress. So eventually, it will become reasonable and natural to take a deep breath and dive and make the trip.
And so, as that Hawaiian experiment continues, now with a new crew out exploring make-believe Mars, they take those deep breaths and they dream. After all, what a trip it would be. Paul Hunter, CBC News, Earth.